Hello everyone, my name is Paul Hofman. I'm working in the University Côte d'Azur, Nice, France. And today it's a pleasure to talk about the interest of liquid biopsy in advanced lung cancer and to show the interest of using liquid biopsy versus tissue biopsy in these patients. Here is my disclosures. It's quite well known that when we use new therapies in lung cancer patients, we need to take care about a lot of different parameters. Of course, it's obvious that we need to give the right drug to the right patient and at the right time. But also, we need to use the right approach. I mean, should we use targeted sequencing or next generation sequencing? And of course, we need also to integrate the budget and so the right cost for doing this different testing. On the next slide, I will explain that something very important is to control the turnaround time for getting the results. Of course, the results should be obtained as soon as possible for the physicians to be able to treat the patients with the right therapy. And we know that it's quite impossible to give targeted therapy if the results came in more than 10 days. And the report should be done as soon as possible. And of course, for that, it's possible to try to use the right sample. And this is the reason why a liquid biopsy could be very powerful, conversely to a tissue biopsy. It's quite important to figure out that a lot of patients, even by 2021, at least in France, but probably in different countries in Europe, do not receive a personalized treatment in advanced lung cancer. So it's a pity because we have a lot of new therapy and these patients receive chemotherapy even if they have potentially a genetic alteration which can be associated with an efficient molecular treatment. And by using liquid biopsy, maybe it's a good way to get the results as soon as possible and to get a lot of information by a liquid biopsy. Next slide, we see different recommendations now, different international guidelines. There is different consortia talking about liquid biopsy, why it's important to use liquid biopsy at diagnosis, I mean at baseline, but also at tumor progression. And there is statement saying that we can use liquid biopsy first line if it's possible, and there is different situation or liquid biopsy will be used and not the tissue biopsy. Small demonstration that of course if we have a good biopsy, good tissue biopsy, for example here on the left panels, it's a transthoracic biopsy, so we have a lot of tissue samples, we have a lot of tumor cells, a good percentage of tumor cells. In this case, of course, we can do a lot of analysis, not only immunohistochemistry, but of course, we can add some information through NGS, genomic alteration can be detected, not only the mutations, but also the fusions, the amplification, etc., etc. So it's fine when we have this kind of biopsy. But as you can see on the right panels, and it's quite common to get that, specifically from bronchial biopsies, you can have a small amount of tumor cells. So a few tumor cells, for example, from 10 to 20 tumor cells. And at this time, it's quite impossible to do NGS, to do molecular biology. You can, of course, do the diagnosis of adenocarcinoma versus squamous carcinoma. You can make two or three immunohistochemistry, but if you want to do NGS, it's quite impossible. You do not have enough nucleic acids after extraction. So at this time, the question is, should we do a re-biopsy, knowing that it's an invasive process, or alternatively, can we make a liquid biopsy, a non-invasive tool to get enough information? Is the Nile study, from the MD Anderson Cancer Center. It was centralized at the MD Anderson Cancer Center. And this study, in fact, show that it's possible to make liquid biopsy at diagnosis. And in this study, it was possible to see that all the mandatory genomic alteration needed in lung cancer can be detected in liquid biopsy with a good sensitivity. So on the next slide, of course, something very important is to integrate that a tissue biopsy usually cannot capture all the genomic landscape of a patient's entire tumor burden. For example, you can have some EGFR mutation in the primary tumor, but this EGFR mutation cannot be present, for example, in a brain met. So there is a not only an intratumor heterogeneity, but we have also, and it's well known, we can have an intra-patient heterogeneity from a tumor site to another tumor site. This story is also true for the tumor mutation burden. The tumor mutation burden, according to the site, can be different. So the liquid biopsy is something very important because by using a liquid biopsy, you can avoid to have this kind of tumor heterogeneity. So it's a good way also to get as much as possible the genomic alteration in the same patients. And now on the next slide, of course, there is some limitation of liquid biopsy, and there is advantages, of course, of using tissue biopsy. Tissue biopsy is still the gold standard for a couple of indication. But as you can see here, probably a liquid biopsy is not painful, is less invasive. You can repeat the liquid biopsy during the treatment. Also, it's not so expensive. The patients, I would say, doesn't need to be hospitalized. And so it's quite easy to do a liquid biopsy versus a tissue biopsy, because a tissue biopsy, you need a bronchial endoscopy, or you need a CT scan to make the transthoracic biopsy. So it's definitely more difficult to get a tissue biopsy. And I would say to repeat a tissue biopsy in some patients is not so easy. And I think when you have a less nucleic acids in tissue biopsy, you can get good amount of nucleic acids in liquid biopsy. So it can be, I would say, complementary of a tissue biopsy. I don't know if we can say that the liquid biopsy can be an alternative systematically to a tissue biopsy by 2021. We need to take care about this kind of message. So on the next slide, it's quite obvious that even now, a tissue biopsy is the gold standard. Gold standard first to make the diagnosis, the histological diagnosis, adenocarcinoma, neuroendocrine carcinoma, squamous carcinoma. It's not possible, I would say, to do that using a liquid biopsy. So the tissue biopsy is definitively mandatory to make the histological diagnosis. We can usually have a higher quantity of nucleic acids. Usually it's better to have a tissue biopsy, for example, to get some good RNA and good quality and quantity of RNA. And finally, the sensitivity for looking amplification is much easier using a tissue biopsy. For example, MET amplification is easier from a tissue biopsy than from a liquid biopsy. So there is, of course, advantages. And at this time, there is limitation of using a liquid biopsy alone. So this is very important. So probably the liquid biopsy is complementary. It could be sometimes the only way to get some genomic alteration if the tissue biopsy is a teeny biopsy with a low amount of nucleic acids. I would say the tissue biopsy is still the gold standard, specifically for doing the histological diagnosis. But the liquid biopsy is complementary right now. I think in daily practice, we can do both at the same time, liquid and tissue biopsy, specifically because it's not invasive. And you can repeat this during the follow-up of the disease. It's definitely less expensive. You do not need any hospitalization of the patients. And something very important too, I think the liquid biopsy could capture not only the intra-heterogeneity of the tumors, but also the inter-tumor heterogeneity. So this is very important because you can catch some genomic alteration than you cannot catch if you biopsy only one site of the tumor. And this is very important in the future, specifically when you want to look for some resistant mechanism to the targeted treatment. So I would say we need to work together, the biologists, the pathologists, the physicians, and we always need to think about the patients and to give the good therapy to the patients at the good time. And thank you very much for your attention.